This episode of My So-Called Podcast, we are going back to October 14th, 1997.
Yeah, that's right, Gary. That's whenever Duran Duran released their album Medazzaland, and Taylor Hackford released the film The Devil's Advocate.
Like the past. The movie never changes. It can't change, but every time you see it, it seems different because you're different. You see different things.
Hey, welcome to My So-Called Podcast. I am Gary Linton.
And I'm Eric Spiegel.
Eric Spiegel. Yes, you are. And I am Gary Linton. And this is My So-Called Podcast, a podcast where we go back to a week in the 90s and we talk about a movie and an album that were released roughly within a week of each other.
Yep, that's right. And this week, as I mentioned, we're doing Duran Duran's album Medazzaland and The Devil's Advocate.
Ooh, The Devil's Advocate sounds scary.
It really is scary, Gary.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you know why it's scary?
Because the devil? Ooh.
No, because it's Shocktober.
Oh, right, yeah, it's Shocktober.
On my so-called podcast. That's right.
I thought you were asking why the devil's advocate.
I know, it was a poorly asked question.
Okay.
That is why it's scary. Why we're watching a scary movie is, I guess, the way I should put it.
Yes.
And I mean, I was terrified.
I was also. It was very, very...
By this Duran Duran album.
Ha-ha! You got me.
Do you hear those giggles in the background?
I did hear some giggles, yes.
We have a guest this week, a friend of the show, Alicia Spiegel's here.
Hello, Alicia.
Hey. Hi. Hi, Gary.
How are you doing?
I'm pretty well. How are you?
I'm doing all right. Thanks for joining us on My So-Called Podcast, your only podcast for 90s movies and albums and talk-em-ups.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Not sure.
This isn't even the only podcast called My So-Called Podcast.
Hey, dude, you're really harsh in my mellow.
Maybe we should change the name to Your So-Called Podcast.
Ooh, yeah.
Then we'd be the only one that's called that.
Yeah.
That doesn't make any sense.
That's right.
Maybe we could have a double D in there. Pod-cast.
Yeah, or you know what we should change our name to? WTF with Marc Maron.
If we changed our name to This American Life, we would get a lot more subscribers.
That's right. No, I think we should go by...
Kind of catchy.
Serial.
You think we could get that Casper mattress to be one of our...
Casper? Ooh, go scary. Yeah.
That'd be a perfect mattress for Shocktober.
That's right.
So this is October of 1997 is where we're going back to, mid-October. This would be second year of college, and in October is actually the month that I went on my first date with friend of the show, Alicia Spiegel.
Oh, I didn't know if it was gonna be me or Alicia.
we hadn't met yet.
Oh, that's right. So,
and Alicia, do you remember like what is the cutest thing I did that month?
Oh, Jesus Christ.
I did not know you were going to put me on the spot here.
Gary, what do you think the cutest thing I did?
I don't know. I'm turning this podcast off.
What about October 1997 for you, Gary? You have any memories? You were in the dorms.
I was in the dorms, yeah. It was second year? That was when I had the dorm room to myself.
Because of the pandemic?
Yeah. Because, no, I just didn't have a roommate at first, and it was the best.
Actually, that would have been the month. Right around that time would have been the time that we had a haunted house in the basement of our dorm.
Oh, yeah, I remember that.
I was a werewolf that popped out of a coffin, and I scared the members of Alicia's group that were ahead of her, but it was a long group, so by the time she got there, I was just sort of standing there.
Yeah.
So she punched me.
Okay.
She's like, "You suck."
And that's the cutest thing you've ever done.
Right. No,
that's the cutest thing I've ever done.
Oh, right, right.
That's, I mean, right. She's not wrong. I do suck.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I mean, I think that's the general consensus from our Twitter followers.
So every time somebody doesn't tweet at us, that's them telling us we suck?
Yep.
Then yes, that's true. So that was what was going on for us. Do you want to talk about what's going on in the world of trivia?
Well, yeah, that's right. We like to set the stage by what was going on in the world by asking each other just random trivia questions that is not affiliated with any sort of game that you would pursue trivia.
Nope.
Eric, do you want me to ask first, or are you asking first?
Well, we'll just have to go run down to the rules here real fast. It's 13 to 12 me. Whoever gets to 20 first gets stakes.
Or burned at the stake.
Right.
Ooh, oh, wow, like Shocktober. Witches. Yeah, Shocktober.
Alicia, you're the friend of the show, and so therefore you can help both of us out.
Okay.
Or not, or help one of us out. It's up to you.
Okay. I'll help Gary.
Just think about who's cuter. So again,
Eric,
Gary.
You don't want to play that game, Eric. I'm sorry. Did you say I was asking first?
Sure. Okay. It looks like you're ready to.
I am, yes. So, Eric, this doesn't have too many, I don't see any movie or music questions on this card. So,
well, sorry. I didn't look at it first because that wouldn't be fair.
Yep. So I will ask you, who retired from the editor's desk at Cosmopolitan after 32 years?
Well, Vogue is what's her name, but I don't know.
Oh, wait, what magazine?
Cosmopolitan.
Oh.
I can't even think of what's her name's name.
Anna Wintour.
Anna Wintour. That's interesting because she's the Devil Wears Prada, not the Devil's Advocate.
So maybe that is the answer. Maybe she ran both magazines.
I wonder if anybody's ever watched The Devil Wears Prada hoping it's a scary movie.
For Shocktober.
They're really disappointed.
Probably.
But, I mean, I guess that boss, Meryl Streep, is a monster of a boss.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
True.
Plus, Anne Hathaway is a little irritating.
Yeah, right. Much like vampires are a little irritating.
Yeah, like the next morning you wake up and you have like two little holes in your neck and it's like a little itchy. Yep.
A little irritating.
I guess we'll guess Anna Wintour because we don't know anybody else.
Yeah.
I mean, it's somebody who likes to put the word sex on the cover of the the magazine, for sure.
That's true. Well, yeah, of course. Oh, of course. We can all, I mean.
12 times a year, they come out with a magazine with sex secrets.
That's the answer.
I can't imagine what.
It's somebody who likes to put the word sex on the cover.
I thought you meant that was their name, no. Sex secrets.
Helen Gurley Brown.
Oh, Helen Gurley Brown.
Did you know that, Eric?
I know that person's name.
Oh. Yeah. Gurley?
G-U-R-L-E-Y.
That's a little too perfect.
For Cosmopolitan, yeah.
Well, I mean, her name was... I mean, it really should be womanly, but
doesn't
sure.
Doesn't sound as good.
Anyway, so I didn't get it right.
Oh.
I hate the soundboard.
Gary.
So much.
What Comedy Central series spawned the catchphrase, "Oh my God, they killed Kenny"?
Well, I'm pretty sure
that's too easy.
Yeah, that is pretty easy, Eric. But so I'm going to go with The Daily Show. No, wait, South Park.
Good job, Gary.
Thanks, Eric.
You got a point.
All right. What former New York City mayor filled Joseph Wapner's judicial shoes on the revived People's Court? Do you need me to reread that, or do you got that?
Yes.
I think reread. I need you to reread that because that was like 60% mispronounced.
It was, yes. What former New York City mayor filled Joseph Wapner's judicial shoes? I want to say robes, judicial
just
robes.
Say robes if you want to.
You're right.
That works.
On the revived People's Court.
This is a podcast where we try to read but can't.
That's right.
Former New York Mayor Ed Koch. Former New York Mayor Rudy Giuliani. No, he's in Borat too. He's not in the People's Court.
That's right. He needs to be taken to People's Court.
Yeah. He should be taken to Judge Judy.
That's right. She wouldn't have time for his
shenanigans.
She would go like this with her wrists and then point to her non-existent watch.
That's right. Yep.
I only know Ed Koch. Eric. I'm going to go with Ed Koch.
That's correct. I would have also accepted Mayor LaGuardia.
Would you?
You would have accepted the wrong answer.
Oh, yeah. I'm playing loose with the rules.
What online service with its huge communications network was gobbled up by AOL in
1997? AOL gobbled up a huge online service?
Yep. This online service that you're going to name had a huge communications network, and it was gobbled up by AOL in 1997.
Hmm. Maybe Grubhub?
The pressure is getting to me.
I'm sorry, Gary.
Yeah, I don't know who AOL bought back in 1997.
Probably Napster.
No, not 97. That would have been later.
I think it was Uber.
Windows.
Ruby's up, Ruby. Alicia's a real techie.
It seems like it, yeah. I don't know. I don't know.
The answer is CompuServe.
Ah, yeah, CompuServe, yeah.
You could have guessed Prodigy, too.
Yeah, yep.
Would you have accepted that, Eric?
No, it would have been wrong. It would have been a good guess.
Well, I see how you run your trivia games.
You could have guessed Ask Jeeves.
Yep.
Or Alta Vista.
Here, Eric. What Scandinavian nation led the globe in coffee consumption as of 1997? Perfect question for our pop culture.
Denmark, Sweden, Finland, Norway. That's
could
the one.
Could be one of those.
Well, I mean, you know what goes good with Danish, so let's say Denmark. Well, it's smaller, though.
Mm.
Swedish meatballs don't go well with coffee. But they probably eat strudel.
That's true. I'm not sure we can.
You think we can game this one
out of this? let's go with Sweden.
Okay.
Yep, Sweden.
Woo! You owe me a cup of coffee, Eric.
You're drinking one. Gary, who famously wrote on June 29th, 1997, quote, "Dear Handsome, I really need to discuss my situation with you."
Ooh. Say that again.
Famously wrote on June 29th, 1997, quote, "Dear Handsome, I really need to discuss my situation with you."
I want to say, what do you think, Alicia? You have any guesses? I'm leaning.
Marla Maples?
Yeah.
I don't know. What do you think?
I was leaning towards Princess Diana, right?
You're probably right.
I don't know, though. I don't know.
I mean, I only know about coffee consumption.
Yeah, exactly. No. Why didn't I have the Swedish coffee question?
I feel like I don't know who Marla Maples is right now. Is that a Trump wife?
Yeah.
Is that his second wife?
Were they married?
I don't think they were married.
I think
she,
was just
cheating on her, cheating on Ivanka with.
Yeah.
So.
Wasn't he married thrice, though?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Oh, yeah, no, I think Tiffany, it doesn't matter, but I do believe Tiffany is the daughter of Marla Maples.
Oh.
Okay. So you're thinking this is the Maples-averse.
No, well, I'm, yeah.
He was thinking Princess Diana.
Yeah.
She wrote Dear Handsome, I really need to discuss my situation with you, question mark?
No, I guess not.
Oh, wait, she didn't write a question mark. The question has a question mark because it's a question.
Right, okay. But she did have an affair, I guess. It seems like somebody would have had an affair.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I don't know.
Paula Poundstone.
Gary, you're going to go with Paula Poundstone?
Yeah, let's go with Paula Poundstone.
It's Monica Lewinsky.
Of course.
I think at that point in time, Princess Diana was
already
not having an affair. She was about to die, so yep. She was solidly not married to Prince Charles anymore.
Okay.
And she just had a boyfriend.
Right, okay. That's fair. All
right. I'm only on season one of The Crown right now, so I'm not really sure about
all
this.
Yeah, okay. Well, that was fun. No.
Yeah.
No, it wasn't.
Gary, I have 15. You have 13.
Yep. Now we're going to move on to talking about music. We're going to talk about the album from Duran Duran. What is it? Medazzaland, right? That's what it's called?
It's Medazzaland.
Yes. Yep.
Named after the drug Medazolam, also known as Versed, which Simon Le Bon got for a dental procedure and was kind of delirious for a while afterwards and had all these weird hallucinatory experiences.
What do you mean a while?
Delirious.
Longer than it should have been, like after the...
Delirious.
That's a different song.
Oh, okay.
But yeah, Medazzaland. Yeah. Did you ask if there were other songs out at that time?
I did. I was going to ask that. That's because we've done so many of these podcasts together that you know what I'm going to ask. So.
Yeah, that's true. Gary, some of the things that were out on the record shelves at the time were, for example, number 10, Mo Money, Mo Problems. By the Notorious B.I.G. featuring Puff Daddy and Maze.
Yeah, it was.
That's a great song.
Yep.
I like it a lot.
Yeah, it's a good one.
Number 9, You Were Meant for Me by Jewel, the artist currently known as Jewel.
And formerly known as...
Jewel Kilcher.
Yeah, living in a van up
that
in Alaska.
Weird person that lives in Alaska in a van.
Loves the yodel. And she also would sing with her guitar. And yeah, that was her whole name. The weird person who lived in a van in Alaska and would yodel. So
she played guitar in a bathroom stall in that Who Will Save Your Soul video. There were vines all over the stall. Remember?
Is that why there's that bathroom scene in Devil's Advocate?
Yes. Yes, that's
exactly. Yeah, you. Listener,
I was picking up on that.
In 1997, we were all about bathrooms.
I don't remember the bathroom scene.
Oh, come on. We'll talk about it later.
Okay.
Second half of the podcast. That's what we call a stinger.
Stay tuned.
Number 8, Gary, Third Eye Blind with their song Doot 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 Doot.
That's not the name of the song.
That's what it's
called. I love that song. I love that one. I love it.
Number 7, All Cried Out by Allure featuring 112.
What?
Do you know that one?
I don't know that one.
Alicia, are you familiar with Allure featuring 112?
I'm going to say no.
All Cried Out.
Allure, that's the name of my perfume.
That's another women's magazine.
Yeah, that's the one that's by Helen Manley Brown.
No, Helen Manley White.
I take offense to that.
This is All Cried Out. It's dramatic.
Hey, hey, have you been all cried out? Well, you need to come down to my shop and buy new automatic tears, something or other. I don't know where I'm going with that.
Gary is on one tonight.
Automatic tears?
Because you don't want to be all cried out.
Number six, the Backstreet Boys with their hit Quit Playing Games with My Heart.
I do know that one.
Yeah, 1997 seems a little early for Backstreet Boys, but I guess it's not.
No, it's not. It's their first album. Okay. So. And then number five was this song by Mimi.
I like that.
You remember this one?
I remember those snaps. Is this produced by Babyface?
Probably.
Come on.
Oh, Puff Daddy.
Yeah, come on, come on.
You could tell it's a Puff Daddy joint because there's a come on in there.
Yeah, he's always telling people to come on.
Right. Number four, How Do I Live by Leanne Rimes.
Oh, yes.
Her big hit from Con Air.
That's right, Busta's sister, right?
Yep, Busta Rhymes' sister, Leanne.
Yep.
Number three, You Make Me Wanna ... by Usher.
What? What does she make him want to do?
Maybe have some coffee with his strudel.
And Usher is Swedish. That's right.
That goes like this. No, it doesn't. It goes like this. This might be Babyface.
Oh, this makes me feel really old.
Well, there's a reason for that.
Yep. I like it.
You feel like you're working out in college when you hear that?
Do you like it, Gary?
I'm getting a lot of questions thrown at me.
Four Seasons of Loneliness by Boys Two Men.
That's all of them.
Is number two.
Wait a minute. All four seasons? That's all year.
Well, that's, I think, what they're alluding to is that he's been lonely for some time. Or all of the boys have been.
Yeah, well, yeah. So, you think they're alluding to that? Or alluring?
Or maybe all four of them were lonely for one season.
At least they had each other during that time.
That's right.
And number one, weirdly enough, Candle in the Wind 97. By Elton John was number one for the first time. So I guess she must have died in September-ish or late August.
I think that
and then this
right.
is October after the funeral, whenever the song he played at the funeral became a hit single, which is, sounds about right.
Yeah, it's pretty strange.
Pop culture.
Back to that Boyz II Men. Do you think like on March 21st, the first boy got broken up with? And then on March 22nd, he's talking to his buddy, and he's like, I got broken up with yesterday. And he's like, crazy thing, I found a girlfriend today.
Oh, like you think that they shared the same woman for 3 months? Each one of them had him for 3 months. But that would only be three seasons of loneliness. Because one of them would be happy the whole time. I mean, one would be happy for each season.
Okay, you're right. You're right. It doesn't. You're right.
It just depends on how good a girlfriend she was.
That's true. That's true.
Maybe they were lonely when they were with her because she was just always at the office Kevin in The Devil's Advocate.
Yeah, that's true. Kevin never, he was always at the office.
Kevin.
Well, all right then.
Kevin! I needed one of those from Charlize Theron in this movie. Where like she comes in and she's like, Kevin, they took my ovaries. What are you talking about?
That's right. That's it's a good Keanu Reeves. Again, stay tuned for the second half of the podcast.
Yeah, we're really chomping at the bit.
Eric, we're going to start talking about Duran Duran's 1997 Medazzaland. And you're probably thinking, what? Duran Duran was still making music in 1997?
I'm not thinking that right now.
Okay.
I can't say that I wasn't thinking that a couple weeks ago, but I don't know. I guess I wasn't shocked, but no. Anyway, go ahead.
Well, so this album was just three of the Duran Duran members before when they're hit with Rio and stuff like that. They were a five-member band. But two members, the drummer and a guitarist, left the band.
Somebody Taylor and somebody else Taylor.
That's right. Not related.
And there's a third Taylor,
there's
I think,
a third
too.
Taylor,
no
yep.
way.
He there didn't is, leave yep. the band.
No. Not after this album. I think he had left. He has left.
He's the one that went to rehab.
Maybe. No, that was Amy Winehouse.
No. Famously, she did not.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
I don't think she was even born yet.
But she didn't want to go to rehab. She sang a whole song about it.
Yes.
Eric, either Duran Duran should have ended when two members decided they were done being Duran Duran, mm-hmm. or you're happy they kept on trucking and they made this album.
Shouldn't you ask Alicia that?
No, don't you're correct. Alicia? Yes, you're correct. Alicia,
I apologize.
We ask the guest the doors.
And Alicia, I am not trying to mansplain any questions to you.
No, I know how this podcast works.
Gary's more of a Duran-splainer.
That's right.
Wait, do we know what... Does that mean anything?
It's Duran, a character Duran? From Barbarella.
Yep.
Duran Duran.
Oh, that makes sense now, kind of.
Like all of this stuff with Duran Duran. They were watching Barbarella on late night TV and they're like, that sounds like a good band name, Duran Duran. And one of them asked their mom, what do you think? And she's like, that sounds weird. And they're like, sounds good.
All right.
Moms don't like it.
If mom doesn't like it, it must be good. I mean, far be it from me to deprive the world of more Duran Duran, but I think when they came out with this album, their best music was behind them. So
yeah.
Although the members that left Duran Duran that you mentioned did leave, at least one of them left before the Wedding album, which had Come Undone and Ordinary World on it, which were the sort of big early 90s Duran Duran comeback. So I wouldn't want to deprive the world of those two early 90s adult contemporary hits.
True.
Ordinary World's a really good song. You know what? Yeah. You want to talk about that?
Should we just switch to a different album?
That would be a different episode, buddy boy.
Oh, man.
Although still in the 90s, so you could do that.
There's a lot to talk about here. Let's dive into
Medazzaland. I don't know if there is.
Go ahead,
Alicia. So, were you a big fan of any Duran Duran, like Rio or Hungry Like a Wolf?
No. Yes, but no. Like, I would not say I was a big fan at all. Like, this is not the band that I did not ever have a CD or a tape or anything, but I did enjoy the big hits, you know, when they came on the radio. I guess I was a little young. I wasn't quite, I guess I'm the same age as you guys, but I wasn't
quite as old as Gary.
Right. Nope. Not quite.
Well, you know,
I think that there are better songs like Notorious and the ones you just mentioned.
Girls on
Rio.
Film.
Yeah.
Girls on Film.
Yeah. Anyway, I guess I'm saying, like, I really do like those songs, but I wouldn't say I knew a whole lot about Duran Duran except for the big hits on the radio.
Did you have MTV growing up, Alicia?
No.
Neither did I. Gary did, though.
My best friend did.
My best friend did in high school, so I would sometimes watch videos with her.
I would say the first time I became aware of Duran Duran was when my parents were separated and I spent the weekends at my dad's apartment, and he had HBO.
Okay.
And during that period of time, A View to a Kill was on HBO all the time because it was PG. So it was on in the daytime all the time.
Yep.
And
so you would watch the whole movie and song? Is that what you're saying?
No, I knew that song from that movie. And the A View to a Kill is Duran Duran does the song over the credits. Mm-hmm. And I became aware of them. I also had a babysitter in the late 80s who had Duran Duran posters at her house, like up on her walls. So I guess for me, Duran Duran was always something that older kids were into. Like, it was just before my time. Duran Duran, the band, formed in 1978. So did our cells cluster together in that year and become an embryo.
Not mine.
Wait, the three of us?
No, I'm 77. Sorry, you youngsters.
Oh, that's true. I was also fully formed in 1978. I think it was, but our cells were forming the same time that the Duran Duran was forming.
Yeah, exactly. Yes, we're much like Duran Duran. And that right. I'm hungry like a wolf. Give me some food already.
Did you not eat dinner before this? I've told you many times, Gary, to eat before you podcast.
You're right. I don't want to get groggy. So I had an older brother and an older sister. So we watched MTV plenty. And those songs were always on it. So I always knew of Duran Duran. But I did not. I mean, I guess I heard that Electric Barbarella song from this album.
I had never heard that before this week.
You know, an interesting little anecdote I learned is that the stuff from their first album, Girls on Film, was the first quote-unquote video that they made. And they made that. It was like 8 minutes long. And the idea was is that it would play like on the walls or on TVs at clubs.
Huh.
Because MTV wasn't a thing when they made that video.
Right, okay.
And so they were thinking, like, let's make a film to go with the song, and it'll be a way to advertise it at clubs. And that video is, like, mostly topless girls pillow fighting.
Mm-hmm, yes.
So it had to be, like, totally, like, edited down, and then it was banned by both the BBC and MTV. And that was a great marketing gimmick for their first song because, like, oh, it was banned.
Yeah, right. Moms don't like the name. And our videos are banned. They're edgy.
Right.
Yeah.
And they were not edgy.
Not very edgy.
Not exactly hard material.
They are very, very 80s. I think that's what really comes across. And it's funny because this sound, I guess you would call it new wave.
Yep. Yeah.
80s pop. I guess it didn't really fully exist before they did. So they really did sort of, I mean, it was definitely different than like in 1978, if they were coming together, they were forming a band in like right around the time as like the Sex Pistols and stuff.
Joy Division and yeah. So
this was definitely, but they really wanted to be popular and huge, and they got popular really fast. They went from playing clubs to playing arenas in the US like within the span of like a year.
And that's why one of the Taylors left the band. He's like, I just needed a break. You know, they kept wanting to keep going. And
I think from 80 to 84, they were recording albums and touring and recording albums and touring and recording albums and touring. And they, at 84, they like unofficially broke up around December because they were like, can't do any more cocaine.
Yeah, right, right. But in 97.
There was no more cocaine left.
Oh, weird.
That's strange, because I have some right here.
Well, since then, they've been able to grow back all the cocaine that Duran Duran snorted.
So, yeah, 1997, though, nobody was really thinking about
cocaine.
Well, Duran Duran.
I guess it was really more like crack and heroin.
In 97, were your drugs of choice?
What were the drugs that were kind of big then? Oh, ecstasy, because it was the club scene.
Yeah, maybe.
So probably ecstasy, Special K, Molly.
Yeah, I don't know if Molly was
Medazzaland.
Ready.
Medazzaland.
Yep. Medazzaland.
Yeah, so basically what happened was is they released the wedding album. It was a really big hit, you know, at Kohl's and Great Clips and the grocery store.
I always think of the pool.
And the pool.
The pool.
And then their next album after that was a an album
that was in 93. That was in 93 was the wedding album, yeah.
And then in 95 they had an album of cover songs called Thank You, and then 97 this. Which, this album is weird, right? Like, it's a weird Duran Duran album.
It is a weird Duran Duran album, yeah. I
would agree with that.
I think that at the time, like I said, there was all of the club stuff. There was, you know, the Chemical Brothers. The U2 had their pop album, which I feel like this is kind of Duran Duran's pop album.
Yeah, I can see that now. I didn't put that together, but yeah, you're definitely making a connection there, Eric.
So it's like these bands that have been around for a while are like, let's add some electronic beats and see what happens.
Yeah, well, they also, I think the drummer was one of the guys that quit. So that was, you know, also...
And there were no more drummers in England.
No more drummers.
The Duran Duran spent a good portion of the late 80s just wandering the streets of London looking for a drummer.
That's right.
None could be found.
Maybe they shouldn't have made an album then.
Pearl Jam was using all the drummers.
Yeah, so it starts off pretty weird. Very loopy and techno and strange with the first track, Medazzaland.
Yeah.
And then the second track, The Big Bang Generation, does have the weird loopy electronic stuff, but it also, it's got Simon Le Bon singing, which is, I mean, his voice is very unmistakably Duran Duran.
I wonder why that is. Oh, he is in Duran Duran.
You think I know, but I think that his voice, much like Bono's or, I don't know, it's just a very, very distinctive and a good singing voice, I think. He has a really good singing voice, and it's just so distinctive. Like, nobody sounds like Simon Le Bon.
Yeah.
So it's a little bit like their old stuff with, like, a techno kind of a beat. And then there are songs on this album that are more conventional pop songs. Like the first single was Out of My Mind. It was used as the theme song from the movie The Saint, starring Val Kilmer and Elizabeth Shue.
I think I remember that movie.
And the other thing about Out of My Mind that's sort of interesting is that it was one of the first singles ever available on the internet for 99 cents. It was like there was a website, I guess, you could go to and download it and pay for the song.
CompuServe?
Yeah, it was on no, it was on Prodigy, I think.
Oh, of course. I should have said that.
But it's funny, the record stores were pissed that Capitol Records was doing this, selling this song on the internet.
Oh, yeah.
So they refused to put up the Medazzaland posters in their stores or stock the album.
That's what did it in.
Because they were like...
That's what
totally the problem.
Yeah, that was the reason why this wasn't a big hit.
No. I'm just saying it's similar to whenever the VCR came out and all the theaters were like, this is the end of movie theaters, you know?
And they had to wait another...
Right, that it was the end of record stores.
It just took another 20 years. Yeah.
I don't know. I think on my second or third listen, I started to enjoy some of these songs.
Okay.
There's a lot of dedication. There's a lot of noisy trash on it, though.
Well, right. Yeah. You know, so anybody who listens to my so-called podcast knows I can 12. How many tracks are there? 12, 50 minutes.
Yeah, it's almost an hour long. They are a little long. And some of them are straight up bad.
Like I would say track two is Big Bang Generation is a bad song.
Oh, it's so bad.
Yeah,
Silva Halo's not a good song.
No, I think it sounds like a robot lullaby.
I mean, when you describe it like that, it makes me want to listen to it. But a robot lullaby.
You did listen to it, didn't you?
Yeah, well, I mean, it makes me want to put it on a playlist and, you know, go to sleep to a robot
lullaby. Your robot to bed.
Exactly.
Yeah, I didn't like any of these songs.
None of them?
No. I think Out of My Mind, like, reminded me just a little of, like, Nine Inch Nails, something they were trying to do.
Yeah, there's definitely a we're trying to do what's popular kind of a thing.
Yeah, I think
mixed
that's...
in with they just sort of sound like old Duran Duran songs, which aren't bad.
No, they don't sound like
some of good them Duran are. Duran like songs. For example, Michael, You've Got a Lot to Answer For is just sort of guitars and singing. That is about Michael Hutchence, but it was this album came out a month before he died, so oh. It was just about him because Simon Le Bon's friends with him, but they didn't play it on this tour because couldn't bring himself to sing it live.
Sure.
I guess they did tour on this, but this album sold so poorly that they were dropped from Capitol Records after this.
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah.
They had that big resurgence with the Wedding album, and then two albums later, they were dropped.
Well, yeah, because I think they should have. I mean, I guess I can't blame a band for not wanting to try to stay relevant, but I mean, this album, especially in the context of 1997, sounds like an imposter band just trying to be. It doesn't. Yeah, they should have just did more Duran Duran and stuck to that sound instead of being like, oh, let's try to be what the kids want and right. Sound like, yeah, I mean, that's
and that's sort of interesting that they went this route because the Wedding album was such a just sort of mellow poppy adult contemporary thing. Like they probably could have continued to have quite an audience if they would have just continued in that vein,
right? Yeah,
maybe they didn't want like 40-year-old moms.
Well, and I hey. Guess the yeah, nobody likes 40-year-old moms. I guess one of the reasons I'm not too sure, Eric, it sounds like you're pretty informed on this though, is like who was the main songwriter? Because I was saying two guys left. Was that one of the songwriters that left? And
no, these other guys they had many, many albums before people left. They were so popular in 1984. When they decided to hit pause and take a break for Duran Duran, that two of the members actually started other bands that were somewhat popular for a while.
Oh, yeah.
And then they came back together for the Notorious album, except for Taylor, the drummer.
Okay.
So the drummer left then.
Right, yeah. I think he was the one that was all burnt out.
I think the guitarist left... after the Wedding album.
Right. Okay. And then, so yeah, then they did the covers album and then they did this. So I guess it was the guitarist. Did he write, what was his contribution to the writing of it? So.
I'm trying to figure that out, Gary.
Well, you know, Eric, that's okay. We don't want to waste our precious time with that.
I mean, that's possible. I mean, they were popular for a very long time. I think at this point they're kind of touring on their old songs that everybody still likes from the 79 to 85 era. They were huge though in that era. They were like the Beatles. They would sell out Madison Square Garden. The girls would make so much noise outside of their hotels screaming all night long that they were banned from hotels in New York City. They couldn't find places to stay because the noise was so loud whenever they would stay there. It blocked traffic and stuff.
Yeah,
like,
I mean,
they were enormous.
Looking at their greatest hits, I mean, there's some songs on here that I definitely enjoy. Electric Barbarella is the only song.
Oh, really?
From, that's on their greatest hits. Yeah.
That's a loose definition of a hit right there.
Exactly. But yeah, you got The Reflex, Girls on Film.
Oh, yeah, The Reflex.
Yeah, View to a Kill, Ordinary World, Rio, Hungry Like a Wolf, Wild Boys.
I guess they were kind of a mix between a rock band and a boy band because, like, the girls liked them more than the boys. And the critics didn't really ever like them a ton. How does Save a Prayer go?
I don't know that one. But there was a video for it, even.
Oh, oh yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that's on the Rio album. The Rio album has that Patrick Nagel cover.
Yes. Yeah.
Remember when Patrick Nagel, like, art was like for sale at the mall and you yeah. could buy it framed at Prince Plus?
Well, and
Eric really wants one of those, I think.
I
always just perplexed.
No, I'm not
by
even
it.
Kidding.
It was always, like your single uncle that would have one of
that's
those.
That's exactly, yeah. My single uncle had those. No, but this greatest hits, that's a really good list. I mean, our youngest Adam was listening to this album with Eric, and then he was listening to it with me, and I was pretty much hating it. And he's like, these are good songs, Mom. So I think that he might really like this greatest hits.
Yeah, he would like the greatest hits for sure. Yeah.
I think anybody would. They're good songs.
Yeah.
Well, lots of people don't like Duran Duran.
Yeah, yeah.
Everyone
yeah.
does.
But I don't know. I mean, I when I first popped it on and listened to the title track, I was like, whoa, 50-some yeah, minutes of this.
Yeah, exactly.
And the second track didn't do a whole lot for me either. And this isn't even on Spotify, by the way.
Oh, this one wasn't? Medazzaland wasn't?
We had to listen to it on YouTube.
Oh, no. Okay. I'm sorry, because it was on Apple Music. Little behind the scene, Eric originally picked an album that wasn't on either streaming service, Jurassic 5.
Yep.
Yep.
Sorry.
Well, you know, what are you going to do? But then I went in and picked an album that wasn't on Spotify. I apologize for that.
Your face.
And we picked a movie that isn't free streaming anywhere.
Anywhere either, yeah. So yeah, we're going to talk about stuff that you can't experience yourself.
But you know, you could rent The Devil's Advocate. And you could definitely listen to Medazzaland on YouTube, although I'm not sure I recommend it.
Yeah, I wouldn't either. Are we ready to rate it? Alicia, do you have anything else you want to say about Medazzaland specifically?
No.
No?
Thank you, though.
Yeah. Yeah, I do appreciate them putting the title track right on song one. Oh, the bands that put it, you know, at track 7 or 8, it's like, why am I... If it's the title track, why are you burying it so far in the track listing? That's my 2 cents.
You know, there's a whole art to, you know, setting up a side A and a side B, Gary.
You're building to it, Gary.
Yeah.
You're building to it.
Good call. Good call.
Well, Gary, we have a rating system here. Since Medazzaland is named after a benzodiazepine.
Oh, my goodness.
Medazzalam. we're going to do a star system based on benzos today.
Is this sponsored?
4 stars Xanax, a really popular street drug, mm-hmm. and a very well selling benzo. 3 Valium, mother's little helper.
Yes.
2 Klonopin, really popular still these days, and 1 Ativan, you know, popular for procedural anxiety in the hospital.
Do yeah. I get to go first?
Yes, yeah. Please go first.
Okay, I'd like to pick 2 to be nice, but I'm going to go Ativan.
Ativan. One star. 1 benzodiazepine.
I mean, so while I've taken a handful of all of those pills that you've just mentioned.
At once?
At one, yeah, yeah, exactly.
So you're dead.
Yes.
Shocktober?
Shocktober.
Oh, we were doing this podcast with a ghost. Spooky. It's
that
Casper.
That makes me sad, though. I don't want Gary to die.
Well, you know, wait till after Shocktober. Maybe I'll come back. Surprise twist.
I'll be so thankful for
yeah,
you.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, the Thanksgiving cast starring
Gary
Gary's
comes back from
reanimated body.
Oh yeah, good times. 1 star.
Did we all say 1 star?
I want to give it 2 stars.
2 stars. That's
one,
nice.
1.5 stars.
Okay.
I didn't mind out of my mind. Isn't that what it's called?
Yeah, out of my mind.
I didn't mind that one.
So you didn't mind one song.
One of the 12 songs.
A couple other ones are okay, kind of growing on me. But like even the ones that I kind of liked had like 50% trash going on. It's a mess of an album for sure.
Yeah, it is. It is.
I guess it's a weird thing because we've listened to music that I absolutely hate. It's just horrible.
Yep.
And I did not hate this. I just didn't think any of it was very good. It's like it's not awful. It's not like listening to Korn or Limp Bizkit or something. Like,
yeah.
I know they're trying.
That's a good point.
Or Jimmy Eat World's. Yeah, that was an album that I was like, this is just not for me.
Yeah. You're welcome.
That's right.
Maybe for the next podcast, we'll pick an album we know is good.
Yeah, let's plan on that. All right, well, we're going to take a break, and then we'll come back, and we will discuss Taylor Hackford, right? That's the director of...
Another Taylor?
Yep, another Taylor. This time a first name, though.
John Taylor Hackford.
The Devil's Advocate, or just Devil's Advocate, not the Devil's Advocate.
Oh, really? It doesn't have a the?
I don't think so.
I think you're right, Gary.
Come back after the break and find out if there's an article in the title of the movie.
A young attorney has the chance of a lifetime.
Bill Chadwick Waters, we want you to come to New York. All expenses, first class, travel and lodging, you and your wife.
Oh, my God.
He will enter a place of wealth and ambition.
We've got 40 partners vested at the moment. In addition to our corporate clients, we're currently representing about 25 foreign countries. He's got you scheduled for 15 minutes, so make the most of it.
John Milton.
Kevin Lomax.
Well, what's that like?
One day you're putting them away, next day you're setting them free.
Takes a little getting used to.
Pays better, though, doesn't it?
Welcome to Babylon, Ma.
Speak of the devil!
A world of power and seduction.
Who's that with the senator?
Controlled by one man.
I swear he can hear us.
Hell, he can smell us.
He will make your dreams come true.
Want to come upstairs and...
Now?
He will grant your fondest wish.
I'm just warming my hands on your talent. You know what I see? I see the future of this law firm.
He knows your greatest fear.
Milton is into everything. Arms brokering, chemical weapons, toxic waste, money laundering for the Eastern Bloc. I mean, it goes on and on.
I don't like it here, Kevin.
And he knows the price of your soul.
Welcome back to my so-called podcast. I'm Eric Spiegel.
Hey, I'm Gary Linton.
Hey, Gary.
Hey. Is Alicia still with you?
For now.
Okay, yeah. Good.
Till death do us part, I think you said at some point.
Unless the devil drives me crazy and I kill myself.
Oh, spoiler alert.
Wait, yeah, I mean, it's going to be spoiled.
that's a trailer for The Devil's Advocate starring Keanu Reeves. It's Keanu.
Keanu.
Yeah,
there's a great
Flophouse where they're all pronouncing it different ways. And they make fun of Stu because he says it to rhyme with piano.
Keanu.
That sounds right in a way, too. Don't confuse me.
It's Keanu.
Keanu.
Yeah. Keanu,
that's how
Al, and Charlize together again.
Yep. Was it
Alfred or
in Batman?
No, Albert.
Is Al Pacino Alfred, Albert,
Aloysius? I think it's Alice.
Yeah, could be Alice.
Alice Pacino.
That's his. Right. Hey, stop! My mother's
that's
Alice Pacino.
That's a question for another day.
That's right.
The studio blockbuster horror movie from 1997 for this shocking Shocktober.
It's Alfredo.
Is it?
Yep.
Okay.
Really?
Yep.
That's funny because then Fredo broke his heart.
Hey, that is funny. I mean, in a very tragic way.
Unusual.
Yeah. I don't think this is a horror movie either. I don't know if I really want to get into a conversation with Eric about whether this is a horror movie.
That's fine.
Yeah. I mean, it's a genre mashup.
I mean, the studio obviously felt it was horror adjacent enough to release it in October.
That was just production delays. It was supposed to come out in August. In fact, they really didn't want to release it October 14th when they did, because that I Know What You Did Last Summer came out that same day, and they didn't want to release a horror movie versus a horror movie, but they didn't want to release it in November. So they sort of were forced into this date, but...
Well, yeah, that's a good segue.
It's definitely horror adjacent. I mean, Rick Baker does the monster effects in this movie. If there's monster effects, it's horror adjacent at least.
Yeah. I mean, yeah.
I don't. This is not even interesting to me. So yeah, we should move on.
Right.
Oh, so sorry, Eric.
No,
so,
I mean, I am interested in this, but everyone else is not. Is what I really mean to say.
Okay.
So, Gary, should you tell us what else we could go see other than this movie at the cinema multiplex?
Yeah. So, you know, you had options. A lot of times different movies are out and you can go see any of them.
Right. Except for now, when you can't go see anything.
Well, that's true. Yeah. The before times. Number 10, back in the week of October 17th, 1997, number 10 was Bean. I believe that.
Oh, yeah, the Bean movie.
Yep.
Rowan Atkinson stole America's heart with the Bean movie.
I have not seen that movie. I've seen some skits of Mr. Bean, and, you know, there's some funny ones, there's some less funny ones, and I don't know how it would go for a whole movie.
Yeah.
Is this thing that he doesn't talk?
He doesn't talk.
And he, like,
Bean
falls
doesn't.
Down and stuff,
yeah, he also what? Falls down. He was on Blackadder with House, which was on after Red Dwarf. So it was always weird to me that House became like a serious actor after that.
Oh, yeah,
and
yeah.
Rowan Atkinson remained Bean.
Okay.
Number 9 that week was La Confidential, right? Am I saying that right?
Confidential. It's a French movie.
yeah.
The feminine La.
Right. L.A. Confidential. Number 8 is The Peacemaker. Am I saying that right? The Peacemaker?
Yeah, that I think you're thinking of a pacemaker.
Oh, right. Oh, it is the pacemaker.
The
yes.
Pacemaker, the movie?
Peacemaker was the first live-action DreamWorks film.
Yes.
Directed by Mimi Leder, starring
Nicole Kidman
and George Clooney in his first starring role. Unless you count what, From Dusk Till Dawn?
Yeah, well, I don't. We don't.
I guess he stars in that.
Yeah.
Anyway. It was the first DreamWorks movie. Not a hit, not a success. But no. Mimi Leder bounced back with Deep Impact, the worst porn ever.
Thank you, Paul.
Thank you, Paul. Number 7, Rocket Man.
Rocket Man!
No, it's not the Elton John movie.
How old would have been... who's that guy that's Rocket Man in the Rocket Man movie playing Elton John? What's that guy's name? He's in the Kingsman movies.
Yeah.
That guy.
I'm drawing a blank on his name.
How old do you think he would have been in 1997?
Oh, maybe 2 or 3? I don't know.
Yeah. So he did not star in this Rocket Man, is what you're thinking.
No, that was Harlan Williams in this Rocket Man.
Which was... maybe a comedian that people liked. He got to be in a movie.
His big thing. When was There's Something About Mary? Was that before 97?
No, I think There's Something About Mary would have been the next summer, in 98.
Because I think wasn't Harlan Williams his whole thing in There's Something About Mary was he was the one who was like, well, 6 minute abs. That's my. And then Ben Stiller is like, well, what if somebody comes with 5 minute abs? Well, you can't do 5 minute abs. It's got to be 6 minutes.
I guess we could rewatch that for the podcast. I just hated it so much.
No, I think that's really the only funny.
I don't think Eric can get past it.
No.
It's okay.
And I think that might be the only thing where he's like,
it's possible I was just in a bad mood.
No, it's not a good movie. Number 6, Soul Food.
Never did watch.
Is that about a family that has to eat shoes?
Yep, that's it.
I don't know anything about that movie, so I just came up with puns.
Right.
I imagine that's like a slice of life movie. I believe so.
Yeah, it's yeah, I'm not sure what that one is. Number five was In and Out, Kevin Kline.
Yeah, I went to see that in the theater with my mom. Mm. Gary, you'd like that movie. It's like 81 minutes long.
Yeah, I've seen it, Eric. I loved it. It's the best movie ever.
Have you ever seen short films? You'd really like those.
I've seen short cuts. It's too long.
It's 3 hours long.
Number four, 7 years in Tibet.
That's a really long time.
Which is what it feels like watching that movie.
That's right.
We went to see that at the Dollar Show.
Yep.
This game mall.
That's the movie that Disney is still trying to make up. Wait, no, maybe not. Because it says Sony Pictures Entertainment. I thought, or was it Kulan? I don't know. Never
Kundun?
Kundun. Is that Marty Scorsese?
Yeah, that's about the Dalai Lama.
Yeah. Maybe, and Disney might have something to do with that one. And it's a big thing about Mulan and Disney trying to make up to China because of... Yep. Number three...
We speak in code on this podcast.
That's right. you got what I was talking about.
Yeah, I did. I don't know if the listener did.
Our listener knows.
Our listener's actually the guest this time.
Careful, so.
That's
listener.
True. Number three that week was Kiss the Girls.
That's a romance, right?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure. Ooh la la la, Kiss the Girls.
It's about a serial killer. It's about a crab that tries to get a mute girl to kiss a prince
before killing her multiple times, right. Like a serial killer.
Right. Ashley Judd. So interestingly enough, Ashley Judd's in that. And around this time, I had a difficult time keeping Charlize Theron, Ashley Judd, and Angelina Jolie apart.
Really?
Not like really, really hard time keeping them apart, but they sort of, like, one of them was in The Bone Collector, and one of them was in Kiss the Girls, and Charlize was in... 2 days in the Valley, and I don't know. I got Ashley Judd and Charlize mixed up at the very beginning of Charlize's career for some reason, because I'm dumb and I'm stupid.
Well, Eric, I don't think you should put yourself down like that. Number two was The Devil's Advocate.
Yay!
Oh, yes.
And yeah. As you know, we were saying whether, you know, before the break... it says The Devil's Advocate right there. And Alicia, you right. Called that.
But you're right. On the poster, it does just say Devil's Advocate. So yeah. You're both right.
We don't need to argue about it.
Yeah, let's all just get along.
I do think if I'm putting this in a category at a video store, guys, it's going to horror.
You're not in drama?
I guess.
Okay. and then the number one movie that week is I Know What You Did Last Summer.
It is interesting how horror movies tend to go in spurts of what's popular. So in the 80s, there was like a lot of different slashers in the early 80s, and then it became sort of ridiculous slashers that became sort of comedic in the late 80s. And then the mid to late 90s had these teens that were sort of wisecracking, in the line of PG-13.
You have Kevin Williamson, I think, for that.
And then in the early 2000s, it was J-horror and the remakes of J-horror.
Yep.
Then that gave way to torture porn, which then gave way to like a lot of haunted house spooky movies. And now we're in an era of prestige horror, thanks to A24.
And Blumhouse.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, A24's got the prestige. Blumhouse is cranking out the exploitation. But sometimes there's some good ones in there, too.
Yeah.
I enjoy it all.
Yep. I obviously. You know?
So anyway, Gary.
Yep.
I'm going to ask our guest a question.
Please.
In either or format.
Can Gary help me?
Gary can help if you want him to.
Okay.
Shaking his head on an audio podcast.
Yeah, that was just for Alicia. It wasn't for the listener.
Well, you shouldn't have let me see then.
Alicia didn't even see that.
Right. That's not how two-dimensional screens work here. All right. So, Keanu Reeves.
Is he Bill or
actually,
is he Ted?
He's Ted.
Okay.
Yeah.
Kevin.
He
Lomax
has had an interesting career. Going all the way back to Bill and Ted, and he was in TV movies. He was in the movie Parenthood before that. But he was actually a action star before this. He had made Point Break.
Yes.
And he had made Speed.
That was before this.
And he made another action movie that wasn't very successful, Chain Reaction. Which did bring the world Rachel Weisz, which, you know...
You didn't get her mixed up with
anything. I sure did not. I was very happy to have watched Chain Reaction for that reason. But anyway, the Hollywood money people came calling Speed 2 Cruise Control. They wanted to pay Keanu $11 million to be in Speed 2 Cruise Control, and he did not want to make a third action movie in a row, Speed, Chain Reaction, Speed 2, and so he opted to take a severe pay cut to be in The Devil's Advocate instead, because most of the money went to Alfredo Garcia, Pacino. To be in this. But I guess my question is either he made the right choice or he should have taken the money and run like Kevin, his character, does in this movie.
Okay,
this
I guess
great,
I
so, great yeah, audio, yeah, great podcasting.
Okay. So that was really long-winded. So you're basically saying...
Have you not listened to this podcast?
Now I'm thinking through his whole filmography. So you're asking...
He chose to make this instead of Speed 2, but he would have got paid $11 million. Dollars.
Okay. I think he made the right choice to make this movie, because... Yeah, I'm happy he followed his heart, Eric. I think that he wanted to try something different, and he did, and I'm glad.
Yeah, I would. I mean, if we're going to go ahead and follow this up with...
So you're glad that he did what he wanted because you want him to be happy.
Yeah,
but I guess my question was more about, like...
I mean, are you trying to say, is your question basically...
Correct casting.
So you're...
Well, that's what you're trying to get at, but...
I guess I didn't want to get into, like, whether or not this was a good movie already.
Okay.
I think he was fine in it. I don't think he was a problem.
I mean, I have not. There was a Joel
Speed
Schumacher,
2.
Brad Pitt version that was trying to get made for a while. Schumacher's idea was that the subways would be the nine circles of hell. Like there'd be like you'd go down further and further in the subways. And
are you joking right now?
No.
No.
Okay.
And but they never signed a person to be the devil in that iteration of the screenplay, and so that fell apart. This one kind of coalesced around Keanu and Al, but
yeah.
I guess the question is, did he make the right choice, and did the studio make the right choice?
It was kind of damned if you do, damned if you don't, right? I mean, I didn't see Speed 2, but I can't imagine that's any good.
It's not.
So it's not like he gave up something amazing.
Yeah, I would say, I mean, to answer your question,
it's not a good either or question.
Eric, yeah. You're asking, is Speed 2 a better movie than Devil's Advocate? And the answer is no.
No, I mean, would you rather be in a bad movie and get $11 million or take a lot less money and be in this movie is, I guess, the question.
Okay.
I think he had enough money, so whatever.
Well, I think he he made the right choice because, yeah, Speed 2 was a bad movie. I don't think he would have made it a better movie. Probably maybe a little better because it kind of makes more sense having him in the movie than Jason Patrick's character. So that right away is a strike for Speed 2. They should have put that on hold to get wait for Keanu Reeves to be ready to make Speed 2.
But, and a better screenplay.
Yeah, exactly. Work on that screenplay a little bit while Keanu
does. Are you
guys
saying you want to watch Speed 2 for the podcast?
Yep.
I'd rather watch The Net if we're doing 90s Sandra Bullock.
There you go.
Okay.
or Hackers, starring Angelina Jolie. Or is it maybe Charlize Theron?
It's Angelina Jolie. This movie, I mean, yeah, I know.
What's this movie about, Gary?
So you heard from the trailer. It's
about 20 minutes too long.
Well, yeah, that's you got my number. So Keanu Reeves is a small a lawyer in Tallahassee, Florida, and we what's that? Gainesville. You're right, Gainesville.
Oh my gosh, Gary!
I can't. All right, I don't even close it down.
Do your damn homework.
Shut it down. Shut it down.
He's a lawyer in Bumpkin, Florida.
Yeah, we first see Dawn Wiener. She's on the trial.
We do. I didn't know Dawn Wiener was in anything else.
She's in this movie. On trial.
From the previous episode of my so-called podcast, Welcome to the Dollhouse.
That's right.
That's right.
And yeah, he's on trial. He's trying to get the teacher off because she accuses him of sexual assault. And he goes into the bathroom. Is that the bathroom scene that you were talking about, Alicia, earlier?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's in the end of the movie, too. Come on,
that's
guys.
That's right.
Oh, that bathroom.
And
he doesn't go into a stall, though.
Whatever. It's not
but, if he'd have gone into the stall, he might have seen Jewel.
That's right.
before he goes in, save your soul.
Full circle 97. Before he goes into the bathroom, he notices his client is masturbating to her testimony of him abusing her.
Yes.
During the trial, where she's accused.
So
of
right off, you know that this is a very subtle movie. It's a movie that gets by on very, very like nuance, subtle nuances. You have to read between the lines, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. And so he has to decide whether he's going to get this guy off or...
Don't put it that way.
You're right. Yes.
Because he's going to take care of that himself.
Yeah, exactly. Whether he's going to get the charges dropped or whether he's going to drop off the case. And he decides that he wins the case. He gets the teacher off.
By being pretty mean to Wiener Dog.
Yeah, well, who doesn't want to be mean to Wiener Dog?
Oh, gosh, you guys.
But he is pretty mean to her.
Right.
Sort of attacks her credibility, you know.
Right.
And immediately afterwards, he and Charlize Theron and the local reporter, they go do tequila shots. Because, you know, when you get a pedophile off on his charges.
Yeah, you got to celebrate.
A teenager, you got to go do shots. And then shove your face right up into your wife's butt in public. Did you notice that?
I noticed it.
Full on, got down on his knees and, like, kissed her behind at the bar.
He bit it.
Did he? Yeah. You're right.
I mean, I was convinced that they had a very good relationship at the beginning of the movie. I will say that. Based on that and other evidence.
And then they're celebrating and he gets a call or he gets somebody asks him to come to New York because they want to hire him as a lawyer. And so him and Charlize Theron go to New York and they meet Al Pacino, who's the devil. That's the movie.
End of the movie.
So this is an interesting point because I think that the screenplay is structured somewhat like, it's a surprise that he is actually the devil.
Yep.
That's what I couldn't determine.
But it's also very obvious that he is the devil all throughout because, A, it's Al Pacino, so he's like a major star, and the movie's called The Devil's Advocate, and the trailer gave it away.
Yeah, yeah.
The menu of this DVD gave it away.
Oh, really?
It's like there's all these flames and everything.
Well, you know what? I guess if you get in the DVD, you've probably already seen the movie.
Right.
And so...
Well, his name is also John Milton, which is like wink, wink, nudge, nudge, Paradise Lost.
Yep.
But the... anyway, so the film is structured as a Faustian tale, right? So he meets John Milton and his big law firm. The first, I want to say, 30, 40% of the movie is strictly a, this is a powerful law firm that's a big deal in New York City. And there's a lot of real estate porn and...
Yep.
And I was like, wait, porn.
Who wrote this? John Grisham?
Yeah. It's interesting because it is a lot like The Firm. The story of The Firm being that a promising poor lawyer from the South gets recruited by a powerful law firm that turns out to be the law firm of the mafia.
Well, thanks for giving that away. I've never seen
spoiler
it.
Alert for The Firm.
Yeah, spoiler alert for The Firm, which came out in 1993, and the book came out in 1991. But so I thought, you know, this is really kind of like The Firm with the devil. But also, this is also based on a book which came out before The Firm. So it is not as much, although I don't know what that book is like. But there's a lot of so for me, the most entertaining stuff in this movie is the big city, New York, big apartment, big offices, big view, big fancy, highfalutin. He's getting romanced by the big, powerful city, the big leagues, you know, the show.
Yeah.
And can he hack it up there?
Right.
And I do like a lot of those scenes. And I also like the late 90s glamorous version of glamorous New York City, as displayed in this movie. I find that to be very entertaining, as only a big budget Hollywood movie can kind of show. And I think that it is a New York that is maybe different than would be depicted in the early 90s or the 80s for sure. It's that new Giuliani kind of upscale New York,
the
right?
Clean, like the clean New York.
The law firm and the apartment that he lives in are right on Central Park, and all these great views and beautiful people and all this stuff. So I enjoyed that part of it.
Okay.
And I feel
But then
like,
Craig T. Nelson kills his wife and son, right?
Not before Delroy Lindo kills a goat.
Oh, that's right. Oh, yeah. Delroy Lindo's great. Is he great in this? I don't. I mean, he doesn't have much to do.
For like 2 minutes.
That's right. But he's great.
And this was after Clockers, where he's like one of the main characters, and he's really good in that movie. So like,
Clockers
this is
was
not...
1998, wasn't it?
No, I. The only reason I know when Clockers came out is that I reviewed it for my high school newspaper.
Oh, okay.
I want to read that.
I said, wait for the DVD or the videotape, probably.
It's a 1995 film. Okay.
But he's really, really good in that movie, and he is a major force, whereas in this, he's like a stereotype.
He's great in anything he does, and even in the stereotype, he's fine.
He's pretty good.
He should have been in Speed 2.
Yeah.
Yeah, right.
Hey, Hollywood, give Delroy Lindo $11 million.
That's right. And put him on a boat with Sandra Bullock.
I would watch that.
You know, whenever I think of really fast vehicles, I think of cruise ships, Gary.
Yeah, well, it's called cruise control.
Great plan, Hollywood.
Yeah.
This boat's going really fast.
Derailed us. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
The Delroy Lindo,
a variety of cases.
Yeah, he does cases. But then the big one's the murder case with Craig T. Nelson.
Right, from Poltergeist and Coach.
That's right.
He's I think supposed to be Trumpian because he's a real estate developer that's doing a lot of illegal stuff. Everybody hates him. And in the one scene in his apartment, there's like the golden chairs and the golden ceiling and everything. So I really do think that he's supposed to be a Trump-like villain.
Yeah, I think so. Although I think Trump was name-checked at the party.
Yes, right. He was.
Yeah.
And it's funny because, like, yeah, it's a who's who of powerful people in the social scene of New York at this party. But it's also like they're villains. They're all evil villains, right? Because they're in league with the devil.
Yep.
And, like, I wondered, watching it, there's a scene where Kevin and John go to a boxing match and Don King comes up and, like, gives him a hug. And it's like, it's really Don King. And does John King know that he's like the movie's kind of saying like here the joke is that Don King is evil?
Yeah, I doubt it.
He's not aware. He's just like, I'm in a movie.
That's right. Yep. Yep. So
he's doing all the cases. He's great. He's never lost a case. You didn't mention.
Oh, that's right.
Marriage. What's happening to his marriage?
That's right. You tell us.
Yes. What's going on with his wife?
She is not having a good time in the big city.
At first, she's down.
Yeah.
She's like, this apartment is large.
Yeah, she's living large.
She gets really stressed out choosing paint colors.
So the paint colors thing, I think, was interesting because at first I was like, what's going on here? But it was, they went back to it again and again. And I think it was, this is the color I like. And these new women are like, no, you don't want that. Right. You want this. And then she would try again. And they're like, no, you don't want that. So she's like second guessing herself. Finally, she paints it this gross yellow, right? That like nobody likes.
Yeah.
And so I guess it's trying to be a metaphor for like she's trying to fit in, but she's not being herself, I guess.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is the same with,
do you
like,
think that's with her hair too?
Well, the hair.
Yeah,
a hair. I wondered if that.
Hair.
I wonder if that was.
I think that was more of a test of, I don't know, but it might have been more of a test of can he influence her?
Honestly, the scene where he was talking to her and telling her that she needed to cut her hair and asking her to hold her hair up, other than the like crass part where he says people are think we're going to be screwing each other. Like,
yeah,
I thought that whole interaction was actually pretty good.
It was.
And that's the stuff I really actually enjoyed in the movie, too, is whenever John Milton's like trying to manipulate people subtly.
Yeah.
And he's kind of compelling.
I agree.
I kind of like that. Yeah, the scene where he's like, "Oh well, yeah, go take care of your wife. Everybody will understand."
My wife.
Exactly. I thought that I liked that part too, where he's like, because he is convincing to be like, "Yeah, go take care of her. You're off the case. Well, we'll get somebody else."
So we should say it wasn't really about paint colors, right, guys? She is starting to feel like something is really wrong. Obviously, Kevin is never home. He's very busy with lawyering.
Well, he had that bad experience when he was a kid being home alone.
True.
Kevin.
He continually like leaves her places. Well, maybe just the one time. But she specifically says, do not leave me at this party alone. He goes up to the Devil's Tower. And
that's a different movie.
He's like minor league betrayed.
He went to Wisconsin. Oh man, I messed up the joke. Wyoming to the Devil's Tower.
Yep.
I do wonder if there's something. I mean, is cutting your hair or changing your hair kind of a metaphor for something? But then later on in the movie, Connie Nielsen's character has similar. Like long curly hair.
Yeah. Well,
he wants them to look more different from one another, perhaps.
Well,
we might be reading too much into the hair.
No, I think Keanu Reeves says he likes her hair. He preferred the hair when it was curly because when she gets the haircut, he's like, it looks fine. You know,
yeah, he'll never really just say, like, she's begging him. Basically to say, you're not going to leave me. And he just kind of keeps saying, it's okay, it's okay. He won't say, I love you. I'm never going to leave you. I love your hair.
Like right.
He's He's trying to calm her, and he cares, but he's not doing all the right things.
Which is what is the theme of the movie, which comes out. I think that I enjoy that this movie is about, you know, this Faustian bargain and slow. Like, it's not like he said, if you sell your soul to the devil, you get X, Y, and Z.
Right,
it's like he slowly sinks into it and makes his own choices. I like all of that. I don't know that I need Al Pacino to explain the movie to me in long speeches over and over again.
Yeah, the Jeffrey Jones dying scene was...
Barzum.
Yeah, whatever his name was.
Barzum.
Oh, yep. The guy that was running in the
park. Yeah,
so, yeah, there's a scene where Jeffrey Jones' character... he's in trouble with the law, and so John wants to kind of get rid of him. He's also being kind of belligerent with John.
Kevin.
And so he gets...
Oh, no, also with...
And he gets beaten to death by some homeless people who their faces transform into demons or monsters or something. I have no idea what John Milton's speech during that portion of the movie is supposed to... say about anything.
Right. Yeah. It just
water's poisoned and the this and that.
Yes.
I don't know what.
I was hoping you guys would explain that to me.
No, it didn't make any sense. And I even found it to be even like he's making a speech. I'm going to try to pay attention to it. But at the same time, I'm trying to watch for the movie. And then so it was like, it was too incongruous to kind of keep it all in my head during that.
Exactly.
That's how I felt. Like, I felt like I had to watch the man being beaten to death. And I got the idea that Al Pacino's character was giving his sermon, you know?
His sermon later on in the movie in the climax is actually, like, he didn't need to explain the whole movie to us. But then once he got to sort of his seductive sort of, why would you want to worship God stuff? And like, I'm more fun. And I felt like he was in a better way than a lot of movies. Like when the bad guy makes the big speech, you know, usually it's like, he's just so obviously bad. Whereas I feel like they did a good job of giving John sort of his compelling arguments for it, you know. I mean, obviously he's bad.
Right. And, yeah. You know, he's the Prince of Darkness.
But, I did sort of like throughout the movie, they did a fairly good job of saying like, this is what's attractive about, you know, joining forces with this guy. And you'll just once you join with me, you'll drop all that guilt and you won't feel so bad about doing these bad things anymore. And then you can be happy. And, you know, like the sort of seductive type. I thought that wasn't poorly written.
I didn't think that the end was very clear though. I felt like Al Pacino wanted Keanu Reeves' character to join him, and he obviously wanted Kevin to make a baby with his half-sister.
Who was who? Is anybody biblically literate? Like, so who does the son of Satan have to sleep with to create the Antichrist? Like,
because
whenever he decides to not have sex with his sister and create the Antichrist, which is the end of the movie, he decides to shoot himself. She turns into like a green goblin or something. Like, who is she?
I don't think
this is your sister. And he says, well, half sister to be precise. So like, who?
I don't think we know.
Is she?
I don't think it's too like biblical, because it's not like, I mean, like, the son of Satan is supposed to be the Antichrist, just as Christ is the son of God. The son of
not
Satan.
His grandson?
No, exactly. So.
I see.
Which is what Rosemary Baby is about.
Uh-huh.
Remember, right. That's the son of, and spoiler alert for that
90s,
movie.
So I haven't seen
Where
that.
Does no. Paimon come into this?
Okay. How much time do you have?
I think that that whole scene is fine. I mean, I'm glad that it doesn't end with like an action scene or something really unnecessarily gory.
Yeah, that's true.
It's more still the, you know, it was his vanity and he made all the choices all along I enjoy that part of it.
Yeah.
I'm not sure I love the stinger ending where he wakes up in the earlier part of the movie.
In the bathroom.
And then makes the right choice, but then maybe makes the wrong choice again. And yeah. then the reporter morphs with the early morphing technology.
Do you think they're going to make Devil's Advocate 2?
They did try to make a TV show out of this.
Okay.
Really?
It did not take. You know, they used 40% of their special effects budget on this movie on that thing behind Al Pacino's desk. They had people like they had ballerinas in the nudes swimming underwater, and they filmed them, and then they like put them digitally into that thing, and spent a ton on just that. And it's like, I guess they needed a big thing, a big something at the end. Or somebody had notes that they needed some big something.
Okay, so can I ask a question? At the end, when Kevin decides to shoot himself rather than make the Antichrist.
There's only two choices, apparently.
Al Pacino, sorry, I keep saying that. Milton, his...
Uncle Milty.
His being kind of turns into a Keanu Reeves-looking person.
Yes.
Why? What was that?
In order to create that, they used a life mask of young Al Pacino and from The Godfather 2, I think, and then created a life mask of Keanu, and then they morphed between the two. They were trying to suggest the young fallen Satan, like Lucifer when he first fell to Earth.
Was it supposed to be that Milton's character used to look like Kevin?
Well, it is his son.
Well,
so,
right.
You know,
but were we supposed to just be thinking of Milton when
he
we
looked
saw
like
him?
A young Milton, and he looked like Keanu. I don't know. I'm not sure I understand.
Okay.
And in the book, apparently, he was not his father. He was just the devil trying to seduce the lawyer.
So there was the pitch. The author pitched this screenplay to Hollywood as a law firm that only takes guilty clients and never loses.
Yeah,
that was the elevator pitch of this movie. And I imagine that there were several iterations of the screenplay. Some more serious ones, some more funny ones, some more horrific ones, and this is the sort of end product. And I personally feel like, given that there were a lot of fingers in the pot and a lot of overacting and a lot of like two genres that don't really work together that well, the legal thriller and the whatever supernatural horror movie.
Yeah, yeah.
They don't really fully mesh, but I find it to be a fairly enjoyable sit.
Yeah, it was. It was fine. It was good. I think. I don't know if Keanu Reeves is a charismatic actor. You know, he's a big Hollywood star. People like him. When he's not the best actor, and when he's when this movie asked him to do some heavy lifting, it got a little sketchy. I don't think his accent, it was like, it would come and go. Sometimes he didn't.
Fine with that.
I thought the accent was stronger sometimes and weaker sometimes, but it never totally went away.
Yeah, and I guess that, you know, if you're in New York, maybe, you know, your accent's gonna go away, and if you're around people who talk like in Gainesville, you're gonna talk like you do in Gainesville.
I do find that the evolution of Ted Keanu to be sort of interesting, because I would say that most people right now just adore him as a person, like people in Hollywood and also just movie people just like him, including young people because of John Wick and stuff, like really like Gen Zers like Keanu. At the time in the 90s, he was some people liked him and some people really hated that he was getting these some very serious roles because they just they couldn't buy him in the roles. I think he is totally fine in this movie, to be honest.
Yeah.
I think sometimes whenever he gets really intense, like it's you either I could take or leave that, but he doesn't do a ton of that in this movie. And you know, he's essentially not doing a ton of acting. He's doing more the he's our what do you call it, avatar in this world.
Charlize Theron does a lot of acting, though. She has to slowly go insane.
I say that she did a great job. She's fine in this. But I don't think the character is all that well written. At one point in the movie, I was like, is this a badly drawn character? Is she doing a bad job acting? And I think it's a poorly drawn character because she sort of seems like her own person at the beginning, but then it just has to do with her relationship with him only.
Yeah.
And so it's only what she has, how she reacts to him.
At the very beginning of the movie, she was on the phone with her powerful job. I don't know if she was also a lawyer or maybe real estate.
She's doing repo.
She was a repo man.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, she had something going on for her, but then when she moved to New York, she didn't have that.
Yeah. I would have liked it explained a little more why and how she went bonkers.
Yeah,
and
how she was that connected.
And she felt like did John have sex with her? Yes, I think. There's a scene in the movie where she's all scratched up and...
Yeah.
Well, he did, somehow
had sex with her
said
while
he did.
Was in court.
Yep.
And
he's
was
the
that
devil.
What drove her insane, or was like he driving her insane some other way? Because he said he wasn't pulling the puppet strings.
Are we supposed to think she really is infertile because of something that the devil did? I guess it's not that important, but she tells Kevin that she's infertile.
Yeah, and does she need to be infertile if she's going to kill herself? Like, I feel like her character feels like to me is like several screenplay versions of her that made it to the final. But in the end, you know, it's hits a sweet spot for me. There's parts of A Scent of a Woman that gives me the 90s New York City kind of flavor, and this movie gives it to me. I like that kind of a thing. I like Charlize in it to an extent.
Yep.
Connie Nielsen, this was her first English language movie.
Yeah.
One of the reasons Taylor Hackford picked her is because she did speak several languages. She's Danish.
I did not know that.
Say hi to your mom for me, Dirk.
She's Danish or Dutch? She's Dutch. That's what I meant to say, yeah. And she... I think her character could be a little... Like, there's a scene in the beginning of the movie where he's talking to her out on the balcony, and it's like there's some double entendre and stuff. Like, I would have liked for... that to be developed a little more, like some more scenes of what she's all about.
Yeah, and that scene was lit very strange. I don't know if that was really, if that background was real.
I think it was a green screen.
Yeah, their hair, that's the way their hair looked against the background was like, that doesn't look right.
They just used the normal zoom background versus the...
Yeah, exactly.
Cutout zoom background. And then she had kind of a weird career. She was in the Suzanne Bier Brothers movie a few years after this, which is a really good movie.
She was in Rushmore.
Really good in that. Who's she in Rushmore?
Dirk's mom.
Oh, that's not a very big part.
No, it's not.
That was the year after this.
Yep.
So, yeah, I remember kind of liking it, but also feeling like it had some flaws. And that is how I felt this time.
Yeah.
All right, we doing ratings?
Alicia looks like she has some other stuff she wants to get off her chest.
No, I was just looking at my notes. I think we pretty much went over it.
I got to say, back when in 1997, the nudity was really what stood out in my head. But, you know, now as I watched it, I was like, that wasn't so bad.
I mean... I think, honestly, I think that the full frontal nudity of the characters goes along with the sort of people that are in the thing behind his desk. It's sort of like supposed to suggest, I think, like paintings or sculptures where people are naked, I think, is what's supposed to be going on. Especially whenever Connie Nielsen's character takes off her clothes, she poses sort of like a statue or a painting or something. I think that's what they were going for. Also, nudity sells movie tickets.
The ultimate sin type thing.
Yeah. The ultimate sin, not wearing clothes.
Nudity. That's right. That was God's commandment number one. I am the only God. You shall have no other God besides me. But before that, wear clothes.
So there's a rich history of people playing the devil. And I think our rating system should reflect that, Gary.
Okay.
So I'm going to say that Al P in this one is right at 3 stars. So he'll be the 3-star one.
Okay.
In Oh God, You Devil, that was George Burns playing the devil and God. So yep. That's 4 stars.
Four
from the
stars, yeah.
2 stars, Robert De Niro and Angel Heart. Spoiler alert.
Nah.
And the devil and Max Devlin, 1 star, Bill Cosby.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. What would you like to give? We like to let the guest rank the movie first.
Okay. I'm going to say 2.5. So where does that put me?
That's a half Robert De Niro, half Al Pacino. It's a real heat.
I feel good about that.
It's a real heat. Oh, speaking of Al Pacino, I did want to mention that I think in most movies they do a better job of not showing how short he is.
Yeah.
I felt like in this movie they did not do a very good job of making him look the same size as the other actors.
Right.
He looks like a real short guy in this movie.
And yeah.
It's also very obvious that he has a hair piece.
Yeah.
Or hair extensions. Or hair plugs. But, you know.
Well, he is older than, than other people.
Well, but he's really old. He's the devil.
Yeah, he's been around.
But couldn't he choose to be, like, very young and handsome? He was the I mean, not that he's not handsome.
Whatever. That's a good point. Shouldn't he look like Army Hammer?
Yeah right.
That's a good choice.
I think I would give this movie 3 stars.
It's
3 enjoyable stars. Enough that it's enjoyable trash.
Yeah, it's solidly made, you know, everybody's having a good time.
Not Charlize Theron's character. She's not having
it's shot well. It's a good movie. I mean, not a good movie, but 3 stars.
Well, thanks for joining us, Alicia.
No problem.
We always like to have friends of the show on as guests.
Thank you.
Yeah, friends of the show. She's your wife, man.
Join us in 2 weeks. We'll go back to a different week. I've been Eric Spiegel.
I've been Gary Linton.
Bye.